The American Health Care Act goes up in flames.
Washington, D.C. is rocked by 24 black girls missing.
And attorney and former Kerry speechwriter Roger Wolfson is here to discuss the Gorsuch nomination. It's Tuesday, March 28th. Welcome to Political Culture.
You're tuned into Black Hollywood Live, Political Culture.
Hey guys, welcome to Black Hollywood Live's Political Culture. I'm your host, Drexel Hurd. You can follow me on Twitter at Drexel Hurd. I'm back with my co-host, Miss Chelsea Galicia. Welcome back, Chelsea.
Thank you. 2 weeks in a row.
I know.
We can do this.
We're doing it.
It's happening.
Where can they find you on Twitter?
At Chelsea Galicia.
That's right. And you can follow AfterBuzz at AfterBuzzTV on Twitter. Use the hashtag ABTVPolyculture to follow along in the conversation. If you're in the chat room, hello. If you're leaving comments in the comment section, hello. Do not keep them respectful, please. Please. Unless you're on Trump, the Trump Report, then you can take all of that elsewhere.
Oh, right. Thanks for the shameless plug for my next show. If you really love politics and want to stick around for a second hour, join us on AfterBuzz TV for the Trump Report at 7 o'clock, right after I scurry on over from this studio to
literally,
the one
she just moved.
A couple down.
She actually scurries. Mm-hmm. We've got Roger Wolfson here in the studio. We are going to be talking to him a little bit later on in the show. But first, we are going to talk about what happened last week, Chelsea, with the American Health Care Act.
I love
not
this.
To be confused with Trump Care, because you know they're not the same thing, but apparently they are the same thing, unless you're a Republican.
Yeah, this, you guys, this, you guys, like there's everybody,
I mean,
everybody in the room gathered.
Everybody.
Okay, listen, guys, this is amazing that this went down. My favorite analogy that I read about this, that this act was like, the bill was a short blanket trying to keep a tall man warm.
Wow.
Where when you pull up for like the moderates,
You lose something.
So that's how it was. It was this fight between the Freedom Caucus and the moderates. And the Freedom Caucus, they're like my new saviors. I mean, that's going to last for like 20 seconds because
right.
on the next issue, I'm going to really dislike them. But who knew that the Tea Party and I were on the same side on something?
Yeah, so the key players in this, Donald Trump, Speaker Ryan, and Mark Meadows from the Tea Party. I don't know, and we talked about this earlier right before the show, like, who's the good guy now? Like, the Paul Ryan side? Like, I don't even know whose side I want to be on. But I'm glad
I'm
that
not
the Tea
on
Party
any side. I am a spectator happily watching this stuff implode.
Yes. And it is definitely imploding all
it's
over
gonna
the place.
Implode faster than Trump says Obamacare is gonna explode.
But what do you
quote
think,
me on that?
What do you think about the Tea Party? Like, what are your views on like how they went about this whole thing?
Well, okay, so did you hear about this? They all got together and made a secret pact. I wonder if there was any like blood like cuts on hands. And
there probably was.
But they all agreed.
That's why they
agreed.
Couldn't find the bill.
Exactly. So they all agreed that they would not allow themselves to be picked off one by one if they were to get a call by Paul Ryan or the president. And they agreed that they would not change their vote unless they all did it as a group. So they were stuck on their no because they wanted a complete repeal. They wanted nobody to have health insurance. They think that the government should have nothing to do with health insurance at all.
And that's so crazy. Well, two things. I'm surprised they took that approach because there are so many freshman congressmen, that what if they want committee chairmanships later on down the road?
Like, apparently they're not thinking about that.
They're not, and that's, which
but
is great.
But they know that the only reason that they were elected was to repeal Obamacare. That's the only thing. And if they gave up on this, they were going to get primaried next time around.
But that's the other side of that, is that Donald Trump ran on this kind of populist message that he was not going to fix
no.
Obamacare.
No,
not,
repeal, replace, repeal,
well,
replace.
Well, repeal and replace to, like, but it was always two things to those Trump voters. Not just repeal and replace, but repeal and replace with something better, not something that was going to take their health care away. So the idea that these Freedom Caucus members were going to go back to their districts and be like, yeah, we repealed it, but you're not getting anything out of that.
Yeah.
But they all wanted
was just to repeal. And actually, I at first thought all of the glory for the demise of this bill belongs to the Freedom Caucus. And then I thought about it a little bit closer, and it's actually not. The American public who showed up to the town halls and told their Republican representative, listen, if you repeal this without replacing it, I will die.
Right.
Over and over and over that happened at town halls around the country, and that helped make sure that the moderates couldn't give up either.
Right.
So that's what created a fantastic tug of war that could not be won by either side.
Yeah, and it took them, see, it took President Obama and the Democrats 187 days to craft Obamacare, to get it through different committees, to have that conversation with Republicans, and it only took them 17 days. Like, I don't even buy a car. Like, people don't even buy
It took who 17 days?
It took Republicans and Donald Trump 17 days. They thought they could do this whole thing in 17 days.
Well, keep in mind that most of us thought, oh, I can't wait to see what their plan is. They've had 7 years to work on this. This should be phenomenal. Right. It was very apparent very quickly that they had no idea where to begin. It looks like Paul Ryan did it on his own. Freedom Caucus was pissed because they were not asked about it during the drafting of it.
Which is crazy because it's not like the Freedom Caucus has not been there since 2010.
Well, they were official in 2015, but the rise of the Tea Party was in like 2009.
Paul Ryan not having been speaker, Paul Ryan got his speakership because of the Freedom Caucus.
That's true, because they kicked out Boehner essentially. Yeah.
So this idea that Paul Ryan would not go back to the Freedom Caucus and have that conversation with them is crazy to me.
Well, but they now are definitely not on the same side. Freedom Caucus does not trust him at all. I'm not even mad at that.
But I don't even know if they trust Donald Trump anymore.
No, I don't think so.
Because if you look at how they kind of played that, and we talked about his ultimatum, and then they were like, yeah, right.
Right. So this is the art of the deal, is give the ultimatum, say, this is your only shot, and the Freedom Caucus is like, all right, I'm not taking it.
Right.
And then my favorite thing that he may have said, well, there's a couple of favorite things that he said. I didn't say I was going to repeal and replace it within 64 days. Look at all my speeches. Nowhere in my speeches did I say this would be done within 64 days.
Right.
You're right. You said it would be done immediately, very quickly, faster than your head could spin, or something like to that effect.
Right.
And he refused to call it sort of like a loss. Apparently, the inside word is that he didn't really care. He was really over it for a while.
Right, and he gave that speech in Louisville, Kentucky. And we talked about that last week because I think he was in Louisville at the time that we were on the air last week. And he just didn't care. And
right, when people brought it up, he would change the subject. And he was not really, didn't seem really truly invested in it. I think he probably saw the writing on the wall that this wasn't going to go anywhere, except when it went down. Shocked to no one, he decided to blame the Democrats,
right,
who had absolutely nothing to do with this. This is like one of those scary times where telling the truth is the biggest lie.
Right.
The truth is, sure, there were no Democrats, but there was never going to be. Nobody expected a Democrat was going to be sign up for this.
Right.
I mean, this bill was terrible. And so he said, we were very, very close. We were so close. The reality they were 10 to 15 votes shy.
And
not close at all.
And to that point, I don't know if he did his party any favors either, because he said that he went after the Democrats. Like, he said the Democrats were the problem. But then he has this tweet about watching I didn't even watch the show. It's like Judge Jeannie on Fox News. Watch Judge Jeannie on Fox News at 9:00. And then she cold opens attacking Paul Ryan, telling him to step down.
Oh,
yeah.
Interesting.
And so then the White House comes back and they backtrack and they say, oh, he just wanted to promote Judge Jeannie or whatever, which you shouldn't be promoting television shows from the White House. But he says that, and he actually promoted Fox and Friends again today, which I don't know why anybody would want to promote Fox and Friends. But and then that attacked Paul Ryan. So at this point, you've got Trump versus Democrats versus...
Democrats have done nothing. Just sitting there looking around like, this is looking sweet.
But do you think that Trump voters... I don't know what they believe anymore, because how could they believe that Democrats had anything to do with the failure of this?
I read an article that said that the Trump voters were... They didn't really believe that Obamacare was going to be repealed and replaced.
Right.
But they did believe that they were going to get jobs and that they would prefer to have a job
over healthcare.
Why
can't they just get a job that could give them healthcare?
Maybe that's what they were thinking that was going to happen. As long as that they had jobs, then they would get healthcare through their employer, so they didn't need Obamacare. And again, realize that most of these people don't realize that they're benefiting from Obamacare. I remember the town hall meeting with Bernie. Remember, I can't stop, talking about Bernie and his town halls. I love them so very much. Where the Trump voters there said, we don't really think that he's going to be able to do half the stuff that he said he was, but, he knew that coal miners were hurting.
I can't remember why, or I was, or watched something, or I read something somewhere where
you watched Bernie.
No, I didn't watch Bernie.
I can keep praying.
No, I watch Bernie sometimes. Where they said that where there was this Trump voter who went in and needed some Medicare benefits, or there was this benefit package that she was trying to get, and the registrant or whoever was helping her out, she said, "Oh, I want my Medicare, but I don't want Obamacare."
Ha ha.
And the person like helping her was like, "But, you know, this is what we all know." Like she said, "But that is the same thing." And then the person said, "Oh, well, then we won't tell anybody that. But I do want this." Yeah. So, you know, it's anything that's attached, obviously attached to Barack Obama.
Yeah. Hear that now Kansas is taking up the Medicare expansion?
Kansas, out of all places.
I mean, Brownback's probably going to veto it, but then they may have enough votes to overcome it.
Right.
Kansas. Yeah. Wow.
Well, let's talk about ways that the Trump administration can actually hurt Obamacare. Or the Affordable Care Act. So they can stop enforcing the mandate.
But I don't think they can do that. Because then the whole thing will go down.
Which is what I think they want to happen.
But they're going to hear the numbers of how many people are going to lose health insurance because of that.
But they've already heard that.
But that's why the moderates voted against this bill, because it would have dropped 24 million people eventually.
Here's what I compare it to for Democrats, or for people who watch the Obama administration, who watch closely. When the Obama administration went after, what was that? What was that big bill that you were against last year? No.
TARP,
the big trade pact.
TPP.
TPP, yeah. Barack Obama went out there mm-hmm. not even caring about what other people were saying. Democrats are out there, everybody's whatever. And he didn't care. He wasn't listening. This is what he wanted, blah, blah, blah. The White House does not care about the numbers. They care about fulfilling a promise.
Moderate Republicans care because they were freaked out by the 24 million.
But it's not up to, as far as I understand, it's not up to the legislative branch to decide on that's not their job. Enforcement's not their job. So Health and Human Services, right now, they've already stopped forcing people to declare whether or not they have had health insurance on their tax returns.
Oh.
So, you know.
Really?
Yeah. So
I did mine, and mine asked.
Well, now, I mean, this is going into the
right,
Obama administration.
Right, he's not that fast. Right? What am I thinking?
17 days, though. You know, so now we're going into this period where they're not going to know whether or not they can't find people. So that's how they can overcome enforce the mandate. They stop advertising. You know, we went through from the end of October, even through the campaign, through the end of January when Barack Obama left, we saw these Cover California here in California, Cover California, all these ads on TV. Those are paid for by the federal government, and now they're going to stop putting out ads.
Oh. Hopefully people know.
And stop reminding people that they got to stay healthy. Because Michelle Obama's not running around the country telling everybody to let's move.
That's true.
And they're going to stop cost sharing, stop or limiting reimbursements to insurance companies. So stop. They're going to stop paying insurance companies back.
But insurance companies own the White House. That's funny. That's not going to happen. Insurance companies wrote the ACA. Right. Who are we kidding here? Right. The insurance companies are not going to be hurt by this at all.
But those are just...
They're not going to let that happen.
Some ways... That if all those happened, that could hurt the Affordable Care Act.
Speaking of hurt. The environment is hurt.
The thing we only need
a little of.
Oh, you know, we only need to breathe just a little bit and drink just a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, what happened today?
Okay, so the Clean Power Plan was one of Obama's great legacy moves.
It was a good one. Kind of like the Paris Climate Agreement.
Right, and so he's backed track on it. And, you know, honestly enough, I don't even know exactly what was in it, but it sounded good, Clean Power Plan. So this was, I imagine, to promote clean energy.
Well, it required existing power plants to curb their greenhouse emissions.
Oh, that's
basically to stop people from breathing in their carbon emissions. And now Trump administration's like, oh, well.
Although I read that the majority of Americans believe in capping CO2 emissions.
You would think so, yes. But a majority of Americans also want their health care. The Trump administration does not care. The Clean Power Plan also rolled back moratoriums on coal leasing.
But I wonder if we can do it this way, and I don't know. There's California and New York care about the environment.
Yes.
So if we have our own standards of power plants, we will not contract with any power plants. We will not allow any power to come in that doesn't meet a certain criteria. Right. New York and California can kind of determine how the rest of the country operates if we share the same high standards. I don't know. I'm sure there's parts of the country that don't include California or New York energy
don't?
At all. But
there are other parts of the country other than California?
What did I... Oh, there was another... That reminds me of John Oliver last week was saying something, a joke about, you know, we condescendingly call parts of America the flyover country.
Right.
But the federal budget that Trump wants to roll out the new budget, calls for not giving money to these smaller airports right. in middle America. So we will literally have a part of the country that we can only fly, over,
fly over
because you cannot
that's
land
so
there.
Funny. That's really funny. I think, you know, obviously this is the federal, because it was an executive order. It wasn't, you know, signed into law. This wasn't the law of the land. This wasn't anything that Congress was involved with. This was, you know, this is an Obama era executive order talking about how the federal government was going to oversee clean energy. It also, excuse me.
I have faith that at some point somebody, I mean, this is going to, it's going to come back to bite somebody badly. And we're going to have like a rash of like nosebleeds for children near power plant. And then, you know.
Well, I mean, if you, speaking of environment, I know we're talking nationally, but just last week in Flint, Michigan, they finally decided that they would replace all the pipes by 2020. So, you know, like, why couldn't they, right? What are they going to do? Like, so all of Flint will be, you know, sick and some will be dead, but don't worry.
Some will have lead poisoning that will carry with them through the rest of their life.
Right. And so obviously, you know, good on Michigan for trying, but you've got some folks that are going to be hurting. And then it rolled back regulations on fracking as well. So,
great.
And that just ties into where the Trump administration has been going when it comes to the Keystone Pipeline, which Trump signed on. He signed that executive order on Friday, kind of giving them
tears,
the green light again.
Tears. If it wasn't going to mess up my makeup, I'd be crying.
So there's no.
But when it actually gets built, I probably will cry the makeup off.
It might just melt off of your face with all of the carbon emissions that are going to be seeping from the flyover states into California, and we won't know what to do with it. We're really going to have to break off. We're really going to have to just push ourselves into the water and go. Obviously the Trump administration does not care about the environment, but you know who also just does not care?
Devin Nunes
just does. I think he's given up on
trying to even appear objective.
Yeah, he just doesn't care anymore.
So I was like, okay, hold on a sec. I follow politics, and this one was tough for me to follow. So tell me if I have this right. So last week he made this announcement that Fox News called a vindication for the president, that Trump was in fact surveilled.
He leaked it out. Well.
So he says that, and then it turns out that the night before nobody knew where he was, and now we found out that he was on White House grounds,
right,
talking to somebody.
Talking to his source.
We don't know who this is.
It was probably Donald Trump.
Right. So we have no idea. The rest of the committee, the intelligence committee, including our new friend Eric Swalwell, who spoke to us last week,
right,
didn't know who this person was and didn't know that the chairman of this committee was meeting with this source. And everybody's supposed to be like, oh, yeah, that's totally kosher.
Swalwell called it, this is what a cover-up to a crime looks like.
Yeah. This is really freaking shady. And so I didn't think it was that big of a deal for Adam Schiff today to ask him to recuse himself. And of course he's like, why would I do such a thing?
Right. And you know, it's one of those things that I look at, and we just talked about healthcare, we just talked about the environment, and we talked about Devin Nunes. And hopefully at some point we have either Tom Perez on the show or Keith Ellison or somebody where we can ask this question as to why Democrats are not spending money on ad after ad using this stuff on TV just to remind the American people what is happening.
Well, I'm going to be in D.C. next week.
So you ask them that question.
And I will. You're going to laugh, but I'm probably going to be speaking to some of these people.
Go to Keith Ellison's office and just say,
Done
Excuse
deal.
Me, Keith Ellison, can you just, can we get some ads on TV? Can you get out there and do some rallies?
But ads on TV, is that really what people are watching? Ads on TV?
Oh, I mean, I just,
ads
mean,
on
I just,
Facebook
I just,
probably
I just,
slightly more effective, but I get what you're saying.
I'm more talking about the rhetoric needs to like, it can't
messaging,
just be, it
right?
can't just
it's
be,
all about
it's
messaging.
All about messaging. It just cannot be Maxine Waters talking about I'm going after Donald Trump every day. You know what I mean? Like, I love Maxine Waters, even though Bill O'Reilly came out today and said that she has a James Brown wig on. Like, that was bizarre. Like, and then he had to apologize for that. But, and then Eric Bolling on Fox News said that she needs to put down the crack pipe. Like, that is some stuff that Fox News is, I think Fox News has given up just like Devin Nunes. So, Devin Nunes gets there. He says he has a source and contacts about legal wiretapping. So he says
that told him that Trump was incidentally wiretapped or surveilled. Remember, wiretapped in quotes with two P's.
Right. He goes to Speaker Ryan. Speaker Ryan, I got this stuff. I don't know what to do. Speaker Ryan says, this is what, and I was watching long, this is what has,
and you
this,
know what?
Nobody does anything that Paul Ryan does not want them to do. Paul Ryan probably said, we should probably tell the president because we don't want him to be mad or tweeted out or anything like that. I don't want him to be mad. So then Devin Nunes scurries over to the White House, even though he was already there. I don't know if Speaker Ryan knew that. Then, but before he gets there, he holds a pre-press conference saying, we found this evidence. I got to go over and tell Donald Trump right now, even though I'm not going to tell anybody right now. Democrats are over there like, what is happening? Where's he going? Who does he have? We got to figure this out. He hasn't talked to us. Then he gets there. He tells Donald Trump, probably to tell Donald Trump what Donald Trump told him. Then.
Okay, now we sound like we're in high school talking about like some crazy, like he said, she said,
That's the reality of the situation. Like, this is what happens. Then Devin Nunes walks outside on the portico and says, gives another press conference. And it's like, hey, we're here. And this is what we have. And I've told the president now. Oh, sorry, Democrats, I haven't told you yet on the committee. But now he doesn't want to.
So everybody thought that James Comey was going to be the reason why this investigation didn't have any integrity, and now it's Devin Nunes.
Right, and it turns out that obviously Donald Trump knew what Devin Nunes was going to talk about because he was giving his Time magazine interview at the exact same time that the news was breaking. Then Donald Trump was giving his Time magazine interview and then said, but you know what Devin Nunes says, But then the reporter's like, did you see his press conference? He's like, no, I haven't seen his press conference. Oh, well, did you hear his statement? Oh, no, I haven't seen his statement. Well, then how the heck do you know what he said? Because I'm telling you, Donald Trump is a source, but this is like you said, this is high school stuff that you will we will find out what happens.
Yeah, high school stuff, but like world consequences.
Yeah, Schumer's called on to resign. Schiff is called on to resign. Devin Nunes, Swalwell's called on to resign. Pelosi's called on to resign.
Or at least for there to be an independent committee.
Democrats have been talking about that. That ship, I think, is going to sail until Donald Trump does something to Paul Ryan that Paul Ryan cannot let go of, and then Paul Ryan's like, let's do that independent investigation. Lindsey Graham called him Inspector Clouseau, which I thought was funny. This is the interesting thing. Sally Yates was scheduled to testify week.
Yes.
Devin Nunes said,
he's
going to do that.
General.
Former assistant attorney general, who got fired right after everything went down.
Wait, she got fired because, I can't even remember now, the specific situation that she refused.
I can't remember. It was so long ago. It's like, it happened
so
fast.
It was only probably a month ago, but it feels like a lifetime ago.
She was scheduled to testify, but the Department of Justice shut down. Like, they sent a letter out and said, no, she can't testify. Basically, can't testify or tried to shut down her investigation. Here's what I think is going to happen. The Senate, Mark Warner and Richard Burr, are going to be like, we're not running this like the House did. Sally Yates is going to be testifying in front of somebody. And the Senate committee is going to be the one to break it down. And Senate Republicans, other than Mitch McConnell, seem to be a little bit more sane and are not so much on the Trump train. I don't think there's a single senator on the Trump train. So whatever they're going to do, they're going to do it right.
They want to know a fact if Russia colluded with the Trump campaign.
Well, I think that ship has sailed, too. I think they already know that. But how much?
Okay.
And how, so I think the Senate is going to get to the bottom of it, and then it's going to force Paul Ryan to be like, I didn't do it, but now I have to do it. Which kind of gives him some cover. Like, now I have to go into this.
Independent.
Now the House has to do this investigation.
Got it.
But I think this gives the speaker a little bit of cover, and I'm sure that's what they've worked out.
Yikes.
Richard Burr and Senator Warner, they're going to be holding a joint press conference tomorrow to update us on where the Senate is going to be taking that. So I won't be missing that. But you know what is missing?
Girls.
There's some girls that are missing. Which well, not
look
everybody's
at us on
talking
our
about.
Transitions today.
I know.
You would have thought
know.
That we planned this.
We didn't, and it's not even written down, guys. It's not even written down. We're just on fire.
Okay,
today.
So we're making light of kind of a serious story.
It is,
but that actually has some sort of good news.
There is some kind of good news, but so nobody's been talking about this, first of all, which but is not surprising.
Okay, well, this being the fact that, depending on who you ask, it's like 24 to like 500. Young girls missing from D.C.
Right.
And now some people are talking about it, and they're saying, why is nobody talking about this? And Metro PD was like, well, we just started tweeting about these missing kids, but the numbers of missing kids has actually not changed very much.
Right.
In fact, it's actually gone down.
Right.
So, yes, it's true that 500 girls have gone missing since January 1st, but, like,
Which sounds a lot.
But all right. but all but like 20 of them have been found.
Right. And I think Metro Police said there's that they believe that 200 missing people go miss 200 people go missing each month. And that on average about 190 cases on average, but that 99% of all missing persons cases from 2012 to 2016 have been closed. There's only 38 open missing persons cases and 12 in the last 5 months. Only 10 of those people were black, 2 have been Hispanic, out of those 38 missing, out of those 38.
So there is
cases.
Not this callousness to black girls in D.C.
You know what I think?
But
you know,
when I first heard about it, it sounded like that's what
the
story
You know what it reminds
was.
Me of? It reminds me of when all of those shootings were happening across the country. And even though there were one-offs here, one-off here, one-off here, it made it seem like it was happening all over the country. It made it a swell, like everybody felt like, oh my God, I'm gonna walk outside and this was gonna happen and this was happening.
The sniper?
Know. Yeah. Well, not just the sniper, Trayvon Martin.
Yeah.
When all of those kids were killed, they were one offs each once a month or whatever, and it made it seem like it was happening all the time. And so when we talk about missing children or missing black girls or what's happening, even though it's very important, we have to remember that what's happening in DC also happens in Chicago, also happens in these big metro areas, and that, you know, even though that people aren't, I mean, it's not like, people are snatched. I mean, I don't know the situation. Metro PD saying that a lot of them are runaways, but
and that term is kind of misleading because if you're a kid running away, it sounds like, oh, this is a troubled kid. But a lot of the times they find out that these kids are a subject of abuse and neglect,
right.
And then they do try and run away, and then they get caught up in human trafficking,
right.
Which they.
But they also said it wasn't about human trafficking either.
Well, I don't know. There was a really great Lisa Ling special a year or two ago.
Do you remember that? Yeah.
That was heartbreaking.
That was good.
And so for them to say it has nothing to do with human trafficking, that sounds a little fishy to me.
Yeah. You guys can find out more information on the Missing DC Girls. You can use the hashtag Missing DC Girls, and I'm sure everybody has a lot of information, but don't look for the fake news stuff. Like, do your research and figure out where those are, because there's a lot of stuff going on. Another thing happening in the news right now, the Senate is about to go on recess next month, so they've not only got to get a budget through because we're about to not be able to pay our bills. They've got to raise the debt ceiling. Basically.
And I thought they wanted to do tax reform sooner. You think they're going to do?
I don't think they're going to have to do it after. I don't think they're going to be able to do it in. Well, they tried to push a healthcare bill through in 17 days. Who knows what's going to happen? they've got to do that. They've got to pass a budget. Then they've got to confirm a Supreme Court nominee.
And
which,
they've got to meet me next week.
And they've got to meet you next week. Oh. But a gird your loins, Washington. They've got to confirm. I believe that Judge Gorsuch is scheduled to be scheduled to be on the floor of the Senate by April 6th. But here to talk a little bit more about that process. He's an attorney. He's the chief education counselor to the Senate Labor Committee and the former speechwriter to 2004 presidential nominee, then Senator John Kerry. And now he is a screenwriter. He was turned screenwriter. Welcome to the show, Mr. Roger Wolfson.
Thanks for having me.
How did you like all that conversation?
I thought it was fantastic. I wanted to weigh in on everything, but you guys kept saying the stuff that I wanted you to say, so I was like, ah.
Do you ever watch TV shows and you go, why aren't they saying what I need them to say right now?
All the time.
Well, hopefully we said what you wanted us to say right now, because that's what we're here for.
That's really impressive. You guys are fantastic.
Who needs to watch Rachel Maddow and Mika and Joe when you've got me and Josie? Welcome to the show. So let's talk about Neil Gorsuch. But first, let's talk about where you came from. You wrote speeches for John Kerry. You were friends with Speaker Ryan before he was even Speaker Ryan.
Yeah, he's
what was he doing? What was he doing when you met him?
Well, when I first moved to Washington, D.C., the first thing I did was join the gym.
Mr. Wolfson goes to Washington.
And the gym that I joined was Washington Sports Club. I don't think it was called that at the time. But the guy who sold me my gym membership was this young guy named Paul Ryan. And he was very friendly and very warm. And he persuaded me to join the gym. And we ended up working out a few times. And we became friendly. And that was something like 20 years ago.
Was he like a hard worker? Like, is he a P90X, like straight up, like what we know of Paul Ryan?
He's a pretty good. He's pretty committed to what he does. He really is.
And he wasn't married at the time either. So you guys were living it up in Washington, D.C.
Yeah,
that's what was happening. I see. That's what they do in Washington. I don't know.
So this was before he was not anything. Like, what was
he was
doing?
The Senate. This was before. I believe he was interning in the Senate, and then ended up getting a job in the U.S. Senate, and then he ended up kind of working his way up, and he was recruited to run for Congress. But I mean, he always wanted to. He always wanted to work in politics.
He just needed a push. He needed a gym buddy to let him know how.
I wish I could not take credit for that. I had nothing to do with it all.
We're going to blame you for whatever for whatever Paul Ryan does over the next 3 years, or what he has done. But then you started working in the Senate.
Yeah, I was working for Senator Joe Lieberman first, and then I left Joe Lieberman to work for John Kerry.
Joe Lieberman, who put a pin in single payer.
Yeah, and then
we
I went to.
Awkward silence inserted here.
Well, I mean, it's interesting because, you know, Paul Ryan, I like Paul Ryan. You know,
liked?
I still like him as a person.
I'm sure he's a great person.
And Joe Lieberman I love. I mean, Joe Lieberman was like a father to me my whole childhood. And I even respect him greatly. I just don't agree with all of his politics.
Right.
And I think that's one of the things that we're missing right now. We used to have a time when you could do that, when you could actually disagree with people's politics but actually get along with them and maybe find some common ground.
But you're not being paid to find common ground these days.
Well, I think that what's happened is, you know, things have drifted further to the right, but also we have a Supreme Court that has completely backed up all these campaign finance changes that have created a situation of jerry-rigged seats, gerrymandered seats, and money all coming from the same sources, so that no longer the same incentives no longer exist for people to work together.
Right.
And it's really tragic.
Yeah.
You know, so when I worked in the Senate, I started off with Lieberman, then John Kerry, then I was joint staff to Paul Wellstone and Ted Kennedy, who were the two great liberals of their time.
Did you work on health care with Ted Kennedy?
I did. I was working for the Senate Labor Committee, and the Senate Labor Committee actually was the hub for it oversees the Department of Health and Human Services and the Department of Education. All the juicy stuff happens in the Labor Committee.
So then in your experience of working with John Kerry, he was on Judiciary, right? Is he Judiciary?
No.
He's Foreign Relations.
Yeah, he was Foreign Relations.
Did you ever have experience working with the Judiciary Committee?
I did. I worked with the Judiciary Committee. In fact, one of the first things I did for John Kerry was I wrote a speech on his behalf, you know, that he delivered that was introducing Justice Breyer to the Senate Judiciary Committee. You know, John Kerry actually
he's still alive, by the way.
Yeah, Breyer was from Massachusetts, and Kerry was the one who sat down and introduced him to the Judiciary Committee.
Cool. So then, what is that process like? So take our viewers through what that process is like, and then let's talk about the confirmation hearing.
Yeah, one thing that probably the viewers don't really realize, because I think a lot of your viewers are young and smart, and they read the news, and they're in their 20s or maybe younger. What they may not realize is how many people their age are intimately involved in this process right now. A confirmation hearing is all about the staff. You know, when a senator sits down in the ring of seats to hear testimony from a potential Supreme Court justice, they've got all the information in front of them. They've got the questions they're going to ask, all that stuff, and all of it came from people who are just like your audience. They're young people. They decide they care about politics. Maybe the potential difference between them and your audience is they actually went to Washington and tried it. But they're the ones who
People don't have law degrees. Are they like?
They do not have law degrees. Interns? Not necessarily.
What's his name? Doesn't have a law degree either. Senator, what's his? Al Franken. Hello.
Oh, yeah. But he has his funny degree.
Right.
Yeah.
That counts for a lot.
Franken is a really principled guy.
Yeah.
Really interesting politician. But so the staff get together and they come up with questions. They try and poke holes in the nominee. They try and bolster up the nominee depending on their party affiliation. But they're doing all the research and they're coming up with the questions. They're even coming up with the zingers. As you probably may expect, a lot of the lines are scripted. But they're scripted by people just like your audience.
That's interesting. Right. I never thought about that.
So in terms of Neil Gorsuch, in your experience in having watched these confirmation hearings, this Democrats have come out, Chuck Schumer's come out basically saying that he's going to filibuster this nominee.
Right.
How successful do you think Chuck Schumer and the Democrats are going to be?
Well, you know, it's a real nail biter. This is going to be an incredible situation. I mean, I say incredible from the standpoint of an American and maybe a little bit of a fan of history. That's incredible. From the position of a liberal like myself, the fact that we could even be talking about a Gorsuch nomination is criminal to me. I mean, you've got a president who is suspected of war crimes against the United States of America.
Right.
You got Dick Cheney just came out yesterday saying that Russian election interference was possibly an act of war.
Dick Cheney's ready to go to war.
I thought it was treason, but now acts of war, this sounds even
worse. Well, it's an act of war from Russia, so therefore if anybody in the Trump administration, including Trump, was colluding with them, it's treason.
Right.
So we shouldn't be talking about him being able to make a lifetime appointment at all.
To a stolen seat.
This shouldn't be in the Senate Judiciary Committee. And that, by the way, is the reason why Dianne Feinstein and other members of the Senate Judiciary Committee have said, let's delay it at least a week, because we got to look into what's going on with Russia.
Right. This sounds a little bit like Trump's policy on the Muslim ban. He's like, we got to find out about these people. We're just going to hold off until we find out what's going on, right? Doesn't that sound
that's
like
an excellent
his philosophy?
Point.
Right.
Now, before we go and accept a lifetime appointment, a potential lifetime appointment from this president, we should know whether the man is treasonous.
Right.
And then maybe we can talk about, can you make a lifetime appointment? I mean, I would have even suggested that we filibuster, we prevent any of his cabinet secretaries from going in, but the government needs to function.
Right.
This is different. The Supreme Court is functioning. You know, there are 8 justices on the Supreme Court right now. They're doing their business, and they're doing it okay. They're absent a member because of what the Republicans did last year. But to start talking about whether Gorsuch should actually be appointed for a lifetime, when he was nominated by a president who's being suspected of war crimes against this nation, we shouldn't be doing it at all.
Right. What do you think about the fact that all 8 Supreme Court justices knocked down Neil Gorsuch's opinion? Well, not knocked it down. They basically said, this opinion is not.
If you want to get into the weeds of Gorsuch's actual opinions, he's an incredibly conservative guy. If you map him out, he's just slightly to the left of Clarence Thomas and to the right of everybody else, to the right of Scalia.
Right.
That's frightening.
This guy is an extreme conservative.
Was the case that you're talking about where he's the only one?
No, I think
it's not the truck driver.
I don't think this is the truck driver. He just dissented on the truck driver one.
But
he was the lone
dissent. The truck driver one is
that's
amazing.
That's the one Al Franken was talking about.
That case where this truck driver was stuck in the the freezing cold, the brakes had gone out, and he calls his dispatcher to be like, I need help here. And they're like, help is on the way. The truck driver falls asleep, wakes up, his feet are frozen, can't feel it, can't breathe well. Like, he wakes up 3 hours later, still nobody has showed up to help him. He calls in and be like, I need to, move here. I think I'm going to die.
Right.
And they're like, hang tight here. Just wait. And he's like, I can't. Unhitches the truck and drives off, and he gets fired for disobeying orders.
And
Gorsuch is the only one that says he the company was right to fire him.
Because he was looking at, he wasn't thinking about mitigating factors, things that were happening around him. He was looking at what the contract says, what the law says.
But the law doesn't say, the law doesn't have you dismiss common sense.
Right.
That's the thing that people don't understand about the way that the law
Republicans
works.
Republicans don't quite understand that.
The back of Chelsea, it's also the way the public doesn't understand that the power is ultimately the judge's discretion.
Right.
You are, and also for someone who, like Gorsuch, to go and say, well, I'm just upholding the law, when he's picking and choosing what laws he really wants to uphold, it's dishonest. It's just like you were saying earlier, it's the truth, it's the biggest lie.
Right.
Yeah, there are certain times he decides he's going to uphold the law and other times when he doesn't. It's the same thing with the far right court. They're activist justice. I mean, if you look at Citizens United, it was one of the most activist things that's ever been done.
Yeah.
You know? Right. And so it's absolutely terrible what they're willing to do. And then they hide behind, well, it's just what the law requires. No.
Lies.
Every judge is always has the discretion. They have been empowered. They are a representative of the state. And they get to make the choice. And they can choose to do the right thing, whether it's against the law, you know, whether it's changing the law slightly or not. You know, so just to say that you're conservative and you're upholding the law is a big lie.
Oh, but I had listened to Neil Gorsuch's confirmation hearings, and a lot of the time, much to my dismay, he made a lot of sense. He was very intelligent.
He's a smooth talker.
But I heard a quote from him that I was like, oh, this means for sure he's batshit loony. He says, there are no Democrat judges, there are no Republican judges, there are only judges.
Right.
So this level of denial of the reality of what...
Well, first of all, he called them Democrat instead of Democratic.
Okay.
Because he said Democrat president, too.
He's just going to pretend that there's no politics involved in the way that judges decide these cases,
right,
is... it's denial on a new level.
Well, here's the thing. We went through an entire, and maybe you have an opinion, we went through an entire Judge Roberts confirmation, only for Judge Roberts to be the one to save the Affordable Care Act.
Right, so maybe Gorsuch will
maybe
be
Gorsuch
nice
is not
after
as
all.
Great. Right. You never know with some of these people. And like, that's the crazy thing. But do you think that, Roger, do you think that it will be a smart idea for Mitch McConnell to use the nuclear option on Judge Gorsuch?
And maybe we should explain what the nuclear option is.
Right.
Because,
sure.
I mean, this time around
which
was like
is...
the first time. I mean, they didn't even teach this to us in law school. So I know there's a lot of people out there who was like, this nuclear, that sounds catastrophic. What does that mean?
I believe you don't need cloture for a nominee.
Well, if you want I could give a pretty quick little civics lesson on it. So the first, in the beginning, when the House of Representatives and the Senate were both formed, any member of the House as well as a member of the Senate, could stop all action if they just chose to. The House went to a pure majority rule where anything can happen in the House if 50% plus one want to do it. Anything can happen. In the Senate, it took a much longer time. First, it was any one senator could stop the whole thing from happening. And then back in the early, I think in 1917, it was moved to 67 votes would be required to make something happen. So if a senator stood up and said, I don't want that bill to pass, 67 senators could override him or her. Or back then it was him, most likely. Then later on, it was changed to only 60 votes. And that's the supermajority that's required to make something happen. One senator says, I don't want it to happen. 60 senators say, shut up. And now we actually get a vote. It doesn't actually make it happen, but we actually get a vote. Okay. So it's called cloture.
Right.
All right. So a filibuster is any
cloture
senator says, I don't want it to happen.
60.
Right. It's 60. 6-0.
Okay. Right.
Now, what the Democrats did in 2013, because so many of the Republicans were preventing even the most basic appointments on behalf of the Obama administration, the Democrats took the first step towards devaluing the power of the minority. And they basically said that you could get a judge appointed. You could confirm a judge with only 51 votes, but it was sub-Supreme Court. And it was effective, and a lot more judges came through, but it was very clearly sub-Supreme Court. Supreme Court is its own thing. You know, the lower levels of judiciary aren't even mentioned in the United States Constitution, but the Supreme Court is.
Right.
All right. So the Supreme Court, that's a really big decision to make. If you go and say that the Senate can actually confirm a Supreme Court justice with only 51 votes, you have really not only changed the Supreme Court, you've changed the United States Senate.
Right.
That's the nuclear option. And that's why Mitch McConnell himself has said a few times he doesn't want to do it. Trump has said, go ahead, do it, because
he
cares nothing for
president.
Out.
I mean, during he tweeted it out. Like, there was a whole lot of stuff going on.
Right.
So do you think he should do what? Do you think it's in Mitch McConnell's best interest to use it? And it goes back to the fact that Republicans don't seem to be as afraid of this president anymore as they used to be.
Well, this may be one of the last chances we have to have a debate like this where there's actually people who you could call moderates anymore.
Right.
You know, so right now, to get Gorsuch passed, so the Democrats are going to filibuster. That means now that the Republicans need to win 8 Democrats to vote against, to vote for the cloture motion, the 60-vote motion, to allow a straight up or down vote, which would be a 50% plus one vote on Gorsuch. So that's what's required right now. If they can't get the 60 votes, and they have a shot. They've got some moderate Democrats from some swing states.
Joe
and they've
Manchin.
Some people who are up for re-election who are a little bit scared. They've got a chance of getting it. That'll be a close vote. Then, to actually, you know, if they can get that vote, then Gorsuch is going to be nominated. Right. He will be Supreme Court Justice. But if they don't get it, then they need to go through a series of procedural votes that are all 50 plus one votes. It's about five different votes. I'm not exactly sure of the specific number, but there's a bunch of votes they need to do on procedural levels in order to eliminate the filibuster ability for Supreme Court justices. Now they're looking at their own camp, and they've got moderates like Sue Collins, you know, who really is uncomfortable with that and has said so. She's positioned herself, though, that she might be able to vote for it. She said, I hope it doesn't get to that point where I have to,
Right. Suggesting
she's got some room for it. They've got strict traditionalists. They've got people like Lindsey Graham, who's also started a little bit of saying he might want a way out. But Lindsey Graham is no fan of destroying the future of the Senate minority power.
Right.
And they've got Senator from Arizona, John McCain, who also I think is somebody who, he's really come up in the Senate. He cares about the Senate,
McCain has come up in the Senate as if he's like some young gun coming up like Tom Cotton.
You know, he really was. He was the maverick.
Right.
You know, some of your viewers may remember that this guy at one point was the maverick of his party, and he's kind of become that again.
Right.
It would have been a very interesting presidential race, by the way, if he had shown up as a candidate the way he was as a senator. But I digress.
Orrin Hatch seems to think, he said today that Judge Gorsuch is going to be confirmed. That's the chairman of the Judiciary Committee. But you got to come back on the show and talk some more to us about.
I do want to ask one quick question. Do you think, even if the Democrats fail, that it would be in their interest to try it anyway? Or you think they should save their energy for another fight? Is there a bigger fight than this one?
There is no bigger fight. And this is it. This is the majority of the Supreme Court.
This is 40 years.
None of it. My suspicion is the three of us and very few of your listeners actually know what it's like to live in the United States of America with a liberal majority on the Supreme Court.
Right.
And we could have had it last year, and it's a tragedy. Citizens United would have been overruled with one vote. These gerrymandered districts would have been completely ruled unconstitutional. We'd have fair elections in this country with one member of the Supreme Court.
Right.
So you put Gorsuch on the court, regardless of whether he's qualified. I think he's a qualified person. I think he's an extreme conservative. I wouldn't personally vote for him, but he's a qualified man. But you put him on the court, it's not about him. It's about now the Supreme Court is conservative, perhaps for the rest of our lives.
Yeah. That's frightening. So I think, the rallying cry is really, like, there are so many issues to get upset over. This environment, you know, executive order, so many things that you can choose to be upset about. But if you want to funnel that straight into the Supreme Court process, that would be highly helpful, because really it's everything.
Call, I mean, it's your senators,
it's why
call.
It, I mean, it's probably, it's maybe let's see, I would say a solid 70% of the reason why I wasn't a Bernie or Buster, because of the Supreme Court. That was really the only reason.
Mm-hmm. And it really comes down to everything that your viewers care about.
Thank God for our three branches of government.
But we're going to, I mean, can you imagine, just you guys, this would be really
bad. It's more important
bad.
Than the presidency itself.
Yeah.
So you got to come back on the show. And
I'd love to. This is fun.
Thanks for coming on. We want to know more about that. You can follow Roger at Roger_Wolfson on Twitter, and we'll have him back soon. We're going to do a quick what's happening on the front pages of our Sunday editions, because we want to know what's happening around the country. The New York Times on Sunday, their front page, their A1, said Trump becomes ensnared in fiery GOP civil war. The Washington Post front page, U.S. military confirms airstrike in Mosul, which was Donald Trump's...
A lot of civilians died. I wish that we had the energy to put more focus on that, because it definitely deserves more of our inquiry and looking at it.
The LA Times, healthcare failure leaves opening for cooperation. And they also had anxiety in LA on edge in Trump's America, because that's what's happening to us in California.
This weekend was great. There was no anxiety.
I think overall, like,
Republicans implode.
Yeah. This week was good for us. Iowa Gazette says future of Obamacare rests largely with Trump, which is true, because now what happens to Obamacare is on Trump's shoulders, even though he wants to pass the buck off the Democrats. The Birmingham News News, front page A1. The future of Five Points. Neighborhood leaders begin journey to reinvigorate historic Birmingham district. And in Florida, the Orlando Sentinels, front page, had death penalty debate indoors. So it looks like they're going to be revisiting some death penalty cases there. Oh. So that is what's happening all around the country on their front pages. So if you read the news, you got to pick up a newspaper every once in a while. And
Do you physically pick them up with your hands?
Sometimes I go into the Ralph's and I look at what's on the front page of the LA Times and I pick it up. And
you just go in with your laptop and you jot it all down?
Yep. I scan it with my eyes and then I do that.
Wow, that must be a sight to see.
Next week, we are back with Sarah. We are back here in the studio with Sarah Lerner. She is the host of the Hellbent Pod, a political podcast through a feminist lens. So you might just love her. She is a super Hillary fan, so you know she and I will be just fine together. Where can they follow you on Twitter?
At Chelsea Galicia.
And you can follow me at Drexel Hurd. Be sure to leave some comments because we want to know what you guys think about Neil Gorsuch, what you guys think that the Democrats should be doing, and if you think Devin Nunes should be resigning and there should be an independent investigation. We'll see you guys all next week. Happy end of March. We'll see you guys in April.
That's a thing. Happy end of March. Who knew it was a thing?
It's the end of the month.
Okay, yay.
Oh my gosh, goodbye.
Yay to Q2.
See you later.
From executives Keven Undergaro, Dario Kristen, Tiana Hobson, and the entire BHL staff, we would like to thank you for supporting Black Hollywood Live, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment. For questions and comments, contact us, info@blackhollywoodlive.com. Like us on Facebook, tweet us, or Instagram us at BHL Online. And I am the official voice of Black Hollywood Live, Scipio. Instagram me, at KingXOBay. Thanks for tuning in.
Hollywood Redefined.
The views expressed here are those of the host only and do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.